Yeah, so I'm just going to present some preliminary results of my PhD. And the idea basically is to analyze... So the idea is basically to analyze movement, variability, and the case scenario is in human-robot or human-humanoid interaction. So the presentation is basically divided in what is movement variability, how can we measure this movement variability using this reconstructed state space, one experiment with human-humanoid imitation, and some preliminary results. So basically, human movement variability is not considered noise, because when we are learning, what we basically are trying to do is exploring the different ways to move. So for example, when you are playing with the piñata, you basically are exploring where is the target. So that's basically like the idea of movement variability. And once you find the target, you explore that technique again and again until you smash the piñata. So that's the main idea when we are learning, like for example, to dance or to pick something. We are trying different ways to explore how to find this better way to do this task. And movement variability is an inherent feature that occurs not only within an individual, but also between different individuals of movement. So for example, let's go back again to the example of targeting exploring the piñata. So we always trying to do the same movement again and again, but that doesn't mean that it's similar. So there are little variations every time that we move. And also in each of the variations, there are some changes, and if somebody else do this similar task of hitting the piñata, he or she may have different way to move. So that's the problem with variability, that each person moves differently, and from one person, each movement can be different. So according to Preatoni, there are some nonlinear dynamics tools called dynamic invariants that can be used to measure this movement variability, and these are the reconstructed space, which is one that I'm going to explain more about. And then you can also use this Lyapunov exponent to measure this movement variability. So what is the reconstructed state space? So basically you have like a system with a m-dimensional complex system, like let's say a clique, Quintana and Duque is doing experiments with this acrylic of cycling. So what he's trying to model is, by using one sensor, extract all the information from the acrylic to obtain this attractor. So the idea is have like a big or m-dimensional complex system, then only by using one time series, you can get this B attractor, which is similar to the attractor A. And so what I'm doing is collecting data from inertial sensors in one dimensional space, and then reconstruct this state space. And so there are some examples of the reconstructed state space in human activity recognition. For example, here we have classification of walking, running, and cycling. So this is basically the reconstructed space of these activities. Another example is by Sama, who is doing a gay identification. And here you have volunteer one and volunteer two. So he used this 2D reconstructed space. So how to build the reconstructed state space? So we have like one time series, which is like this XT to create this embedded space. So to do that, we have like this XN, which is the time series, and then we create this matrix based on two parameters, which are M and tau. So depends on the M and tau, we can create like very big or very small matrices. So this M and tau values are basically like how we can unwrap the information that we have from the attractor to the attractor B, from the attractor A to the attractor B. And so those two parameters are very important, and I thought, because that depends the increase of dimensionality. This reconstructed space is also known as Tekin's theorem, and so M. So we have to have M, the value of M, very big, in order to unfold the attractor, and also, and T should be more or larger than zero to maximize the information in the attractor. So those are the two main values for the reconstructed space. And to choose those M and tau values, there are algorithms to compute the optimal parameters, which are the false nearest neighbor root and mutual information. However, Sama mentioned that once you compute these optimal parameters using these algorithms, that doesn't mean that you are going to get the best rate of recognition. So this is the general framework to create this reconstructed space. We have the raw data from the inertial sensors, then the Tekin's theorem, which basically increases the dimensionality of the data using M and tau, which M is the dimension and tau is the time delay. And then it's another reduction is applied, which is basically PCA, to create this reconstructed spaces. So how I'm using this reconstructed space is by trying to analyze variability in this experiment, in which I ask participants to imitate their robot. So for example, I have four experiments in which I ask participants to follow what their robot is doing. So in this example, the robot moves their arm horizontal in normal and faster, and the other experiment is to follow the robot that creates this vertical movement in normal and faster, just to create or to try to understand more about how people moves, because I want to know how, like, the differences when it, although it's very simple movement, I want to know how but the variation of movement change in per person. So I have this four cases, horizontal normal, horizontal faster, vertical normal, and vertical faster. And I use this inertial sensor attached to the wrist of the participant and sensors attached to the wrist of the robot. And I, for one of my experiments, I collected data from 20 right-handed healthy participants. So these are some results from the raw data from the humanoid robot, which basically is the accelerometer in the X, Y, and Z. So here I have the horizontal normal, horizontal faster, vertical normal, and vertical faster. This is the for the first trial of the robot, second trial until 20 trial, because I have 20 participants. So this is the only for the axis X for the accelerometer. This is for axis Y and axis Z. So again, I have like this a scenario which the robot moves their arm horizontally, vertically, in normal and faster, and then I collect data from the inertial sensor to get the X, Y, and Z acceleration. So as you can see, for example, in this for this vertical normal for the Z axis in the accelerometer, because the robot moves consistently each time, you can see the similarities. And that's the raw data. Then here in this example, you can see this sort of noise because the robot was a bit jerky when he do this movement. So that's why I get this sort of like noisy data or high frequency components. And then I smooth the data because I just want to get rid of these high frequencies. So I smooth the data just to, like just to visually understand more about this variability. So this is again the robot movement for participant 1, 2, until 20. So. What I want to see here is how consistent is the robot, because the robot has very minimal variation. He can consistently do the same movement. But that doesn't happen with humans, because each person moves differently. It's very simple movement. Like, for example, this participant one is, I don't know, slightly different than participant two. So for example, participant, I think this is a 15, is sort of different. So I want to know what how to measure this human robot imitation, and how to measure this variability across participants and within a participant. And then I also apply the I smooth the data just visually look to look like the similarities between participants. So this is also another good visualization of how each participant varies in each of these activities. And so let me show you the reconstructed spaces of the humanoid robot and the participants.
So, am I right in thinking that all of these measurements are in a fixed three-dimensional space, coordinate space? So, for instance, if the robot walks, then although it's doing exactly the same thing, going up and down relative to its own body, its motion in the three-dimensional space will be totally different.
I'm
just asking a question at this
point. That's a good question because that's a good point because I'm only attaching the sensors to the person and to the robot, so they can be anywhere.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So there is no constraint about where you are.
So the sensors don't operate relative to some fixed framework in the environment.
No. Okay, so these are the results from the trial one from the humanoid robot using the smooth data. So this is for the horizontal normal, horizontal faster, vertical normal, and vertical faster. And this is the 3D reconstructed space. And this is only the projection from the XY. Because I'm producing the data from PCA, this is PCA 1 versus PC 2, PC 3, PC 1 and PC 3. So just visually, I want to understand how this each of these scenarios change. So I can. Well, just by eye, I can now visualize like this projection that this one is different than this. But if I want to make differences between horizontal faster and vertical faster, I might think that this is the same movement. But then I have this other projection that may help me to differentiate between this horizontal faster and horizontal and vertical faster. So that's the first trial of the robot. This is the trial number 10 and the trial 20. So because I have 20 participants, I'm only presenting the three examples. So I'm going to just show you like how each three trials look sort of similar, but I'm still trying to understand what is happening with the robot because it's supposedly to be similar. So I don't know why. Well, I still don't know why. Maybe I'm just not getting the. I don't know, using the same time series for getting this state space, but it's sort of similar, but at least I can use, for example, this the first and the second component to create a metrics to measure this variability between the robot and the person. So that's only for the humanoid robot. This is for the person. So this participant one, participant two, participant 10, sorry, and participant 20. So I'm just for horizontal faster, I'm focusing on this sort of circular shape. To measure how well a participant imitates the robot. But then what happens if I want to measure how people move when he did the horizontal normal? So I have to just create another metric to measure this circumferences or this pattern. So I'm still like trying to find different ways to measure this variation. So what I did for the circular shapes is to create like just basically because the robot is quite consistent. I create this Euclidean distances from the center to this to each of these points. Because and then I did for participant for the robot participant one and participant five. This is only for 12 participants. So because of the robot is quite consistent, I get this like this very tiny variation. But when I plot the the distances from each of the points from participant pi, I can see that there is a big variation because he was not really good in imitating the robot. And participant one was like sort of close to the robot imitation. And the question is, who is the good imitator in this scenario? Because it may be that a participant five just did some minor changes, but there is no metric actually who can tell me who is a good imitator or badly imitator. That's the main problem that I'm still trying to figure it out. How can I measure the variability across participants and within within movements, and so these are my conclusions. Basically, the reconstructed state space is visually a good representation of the variability of activities, and I use this Euclidean distances in the reconstructed state space to differentiate the variability for these participants. That's the positive thing. The negative thing is that the quality of this metric or the Euclidean distances is debatable and needs further investigation because I found like another ways to measure the I'm quite sure that there might be a better way to measure this variation of these circular shapes or these trajectories in that state space. So my future goal is have a better understanding of the time delay embedding because basically time delay embedding are copies of the signals of the time series from the inertial sensors. And I want to implement the Lyapunov exponent that Lyapunov exponent may help me to have another metric to measure this variability. And finally, I want to use convolutional neural networks to classify this movement variability. So this is basically my presentation, and I'm happy to have some comments or questions.
Don't know much about the details of that kind of research. I don't work in the field. But I have some questions by comparing that with speech.
Yes.
If you have three different people saying, I would like a drink of water, and you measure the features of the speech signals, they'll be totally different physical measurements. But it is possible to find higher level abstractions, which is what the linguists talk about, which correspond to phonemes, and then still higher level that correspond to syllables, words, phrases, and so on. And this would apply not only to speech, but also to sign language, where if you actually look at the movements, you might look at two signers saying, how are you today with sign language? And at a physical level, the numbers, the measurements would be very different, but they're actually operating within abstractions, which get implemented in different ways for each speaker, because they've got different sizes of bodies and muscular space and so on. So I'm just wondering whether it's possible to find a different sort of abstraction than trying to compress some very high dimensional numerical vector space. For example, the agents have joints.
Yeah.
And a joint angle between the arm and the torso can be going up or down in a vertical plane. It can be rotating horizontally, or it could be a mixture, it could be moving circular and stuff. And then in addition to that, the elbow might be doing something. In addition to that, fingers and palms.
Yeah.
And if each of those is decomposed, separately, you might be able to use things like increasing, decreasing labels as opposed to measurements to get descriptors. Now, I don't know whether that's relevant to your goals, but I suspect it's relevant to how humans perceive.
Yeah.
We don't operate in those spaces.
Yeah.
We can see that the child is doing something very different from the big, tall adult, but they're both doing this. You know, moves the forehead, forefinger to the forehead, and moves the finger.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think I begin to do these simple movements because I originally tried to measure how people dance, but I think that's very complex case scenario because people from different ages, from different levels of dexterity, create different patterns. So I just create this simple scenario, just moving their arm horizontal and vertical. And I'm only using one inertial sensor attached to the wrist.
Right,
so
right.
So I can even use, well, as you say, like the fingers or the whole body. So yeah, I think it's possible to go further in understanding like this. To understand more about this movement.
Just a small additional point. My question was partly inspired by memory of PhD thesis about 1983 by David Hogg, who's now in Leeds University, where he was getting a video of a person walking along the road, and the visual system started with the knowledge that a person has a torso, has arms, elbows, legs, and they have joints, and they have constraints on how they can move, and that meant that the perception was in terms of that articulated description, moving forward, moving backwards, and changing direction and so on, in three-dimensional space. And he was able to hallucinate a robot on top of the person who was walking. And it sort of followed him. Do you know that one? David Hogg. The walking. Anyway, in some ways that's more complicated than what you're doing, but in other ways, was simpler because he hand coded the articulated the robot description. Maybe that could be done somehow. It could be too big for a PhD. Mm-hmm.
I'm interested to know, sort of more generally, if you were to be able to identify the variability of. I suppose I would like a bit more context. I'm interested to know what you hope to do with this ability. What are the overall aims of your research?
The aims is basically create metrics to measure variability.
But why?
Well, I want to understand more about because I just by eye can see like each person moves differently, and there is war, but the reason is that I want to automatically measure this variability. And well, in terms of application, I think there are like many ideas in gravitation, for example. So when you are moving your arm, you are improving as you do repetitions, or in, for example, entertainment, just dancing is just another application. When you do the correct movement, yeah.
So are you interested in understanding more about people, or are you interested more in understanding about measurement?
I'm more interested in the the metrics how can I measure this variability, like which tools may be better to measure the variability, because I read some word that they are using like time based metrics of based on statistical analysis, but literature in biomechanics or sports science, they are doing this non-linear dynamics to have better understanding of the variability, which is something that has something which is not very been doing a lot, or I don't know how to say that, but yeah. So I want to create the metrics or and understand how these metrics help me to measure the variability.
Have any measure of people's motivation as well to follow the robot? So presumably the variability is like a function of their physical dexterity, but also whether they were motivated to copy the robot.
No, that's another, well, that's a good point, because I in this experiment of following the robot, some participants felt bored. Or they were really interested in following the robot.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't ask about the performance of how they felt engaged or not.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it will be another probably next experiment will be good to ask about that, because I'm sure that different. There will be variations also because of the interest or the motivation of following a robot.
But also, their understanding of what copying a robot means, because you could ask someone to copy a robot or imitate a robot, and I might imitate sort of either very completely. I might sort of think, okay, the robot is moving its whole arm, so I'm going to move my whole arm, or I might just say the robot's arm is going up.
Yeah.
So there's different elements of the movement that people may choose or think is important to copy.
Yeah. I think that my next experiment, I want to to understand more about like the person, because different each person, like when it's in front of the robot, has like different perception of, for example, the velocity. Like when you think, oh, for me, moving faster is like this, but that means that has a different meaning for a different person. Out of this, the same movement is also faster, but we have different perception. I think that, I don't know. And my background is not in psychology, but I think that's what I can understand. Like we have different perception, and I can, well, I'm trying to measure that.
Yeah. I had two points, actually. One was that there's quite a lot of clinical work looking at gait and things like that, which might be interesting for you, where people would try to diagnose with muscular dystrophy and other illnesses to understand the progression of their disease based upon how they move and variability. And that might give you some insights. But Raoul pretty well stole my main point, which was that if, for instance, you watch children dancing or doing gymnastics or something like that, they will try to reproduce something. But there are two separate things. One is their perception of what they are supposed to do, and the other is their execution of that. And a lot of the time when children get it wrong, it's because their perception of what they're supposed to do is incorrect. It would be interesting if you could sort of unpack those two things and understand what is it that the child thinks that they're supposed to do. Is it a sort of quick snapping movement and the actual location is important, or is it meant to be a very precise movement to a particular thing? And as I say, there are two separate things. One is understanding what's supposed to be mimicking, and the other is actually executing.
Mm-hmm. And a way of thinking about that is, at the beginning you talked about practice basis, which you might have explained a bit in detail. Mm-hmm. But the attractor may be defined by the aspects of movement that the person is optimizing. So you might have, for a given movement, more than one attractor space, constrained by how you can move, but also what you're trying to achieve. And being able to unpack the data in a way that allows you to define two or three different spaces, you could then say, well, actually, what the person seems to be doing is conversion to this particular attractor space. It's not what we wanted them to do, but they're doing it very consistently. But it's a different way of thinking about the data that you get from sensors. And also a different way of thinking about what variability is. So in conventional signal processing, you're often looking at variability of noise and then saying, well, let's do lots of filtering, let's do lots of averaging, let's do lots of combining the data so we get a good model that would then apply to everybody. It's just saying, well, let's not do that, let's look at everybody as in terms of individual behavior.
I remind you of something you said you might find interesting to look at. A long time ago, some of the other people would have noticed, a psychologist, I think, called Johansson, produced some videos by attaching lights to parts of people's arms and legs and torsos and maybe heads. And then they moved around in the dark. And so the video has only the moving points. But when you look at them, you can, normal humans that have seen these things, as far as I know without exception, immediately see that there are people walking or dancing or climbing up and down the ladder. But also, they could invent artificial animals with, you know, some number of legs, and then they move and walk in some strange way, and that structure would immediately be seen, which suggests to me that we're using some kind of mechanisms provided by evolution, which had to do with perception of biological motion. And normally, that would not involve anything like accelerometer data from things attached to movement, but things like visual projections, and in the case of blind people, more sophisticated auditory and tactile data. But I just wondered whether looking at that and seeing how you react to those moving dots of light might give you some ideas. There may also be research I don't know about on how that can be interpreted by artificial systems. My general assumption is, if you just start with general purpose mathematical principles, trying to find methods of reducing data, you will not find what humans find, because what they see is a result of millions of years of evolution producing very specific prejudices about what kind of things can exist in the environment. Those, even though they're not there a baby, they're stored in the genome, and as the baby gets older, they become active. So anyway, that may may not be relevant to your long-term goals, but looking at those pictures of Johansson might be useful.
Mm. Mm. All people learn to do is, what people learn to do is to understand the practice space. So once certain things co-occur, those then converge onto the estimation.
Well, I would think of it slightly differently, because I would say they learn how to, or evolution is produced mechanism for looking which kinds of joints there are, if it's an organism, or if it's not made of rigid parts, other particular kinds of biological motion, for instance, of an octopus or an elephant's trunk. But there's still your assumptions about continuity, for example. You were making assumptions about continuity also, I guess. I don't know what form these take. So they'll be very different from the things that linguists look for, which assume that there are phonemes, and morphemes, and words, and phrases, and sentences, and so on. And I suspect that there are comparable levels of ontology for perception of biological motion, as opposed to whirlpools, and clouds, and thunderstorms, avalanches. I mean, you can see those as well, but that's a different collection. So trying to find, I mean, you may not be interested in this, but if you want to try to model humans, you may have to find not just how huge vector spaces are depth, but how relationships between parts of three-dimensional structures are interesting. And they may need not this with the precise measures of angles, but just the direction, going this way or going that way, or going faster or slower. And those less precise descriptions may actually be much more useful than the more precise ones, because they can generalize across spaces more easily.
Yeah. Another area you could look at is cartoons, because artists have learned how to convey a particular emotion, and that may give you an insight into the sorts of things that are important in curious within people.
They haven't just learned, they actually often get actors to act in things, don't they?
Yeah, some of it's done like that, but a lot of it is done. They have learned very abstract. But they do have these sort of things that are not like reality at all, to cue a particular movement or emotion. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Should I dare to admit?